Good evening, good morning, good afternoon from wherever you're joining us. And I'm so delighted to welcome all of you. So yes, here I am welcoming you from the learning engagement bought by the Learning Management Group of the ICF Mumbai Charter Chapter. Allow me to introduce to you the hosting team for this session. Nimish is there, who's taking care of the technical input. We have Shweta, who will monitor all the chat box and the Q&A. And it's me, Anuradha Sant, who's the host for the day. We are all coaches from the ICF Mumbai Charter Chapter, and we all belong to the learning management team. And it's absolutely our privilege and honor to have Tushima present to all of us today. Today's webinar topic is leveraging assessments in coaching in today's market. And our expert speaker is none other than, Tushima Mukherjee. So Tushima is an independent coach and consultant with a diverse portfolio built over 24 years of professional experience. She has held human resources leadership positions at leading organizations across sectors with complete talent life cycle responsibilities. Her areas of expertise are, of course, assessments, talent management, and coaching. As an empaneled assessor and coach, Tushima works with professionals from across levels, industries, and geographies. These include assessments, individual and group coaching, 360-degree feedback-based coaching, and leadership development engagements. She is also part of the visiting faculty of the HR Master's program at the Tata Institute of Social Sciences in Mumbai. Tushima holds a bachelor's degree in psychology, a master's in human resources, and several psychometric accreditations, and also a coaching credential. So she is very well equipped to handle this session for us today. So let's come back to the fun fact about her. She feels that she doesn't have a very common name, Tushima, and is accustomed to getting people say her name wrongly. And she maintains a list of all the different versions. So at the last count, she says about 10 of them. So that's an interesting collection, Tushima. So given the numerous questions that we've already received at part of the registration, and also the enthusiasm that all of you are showing with this topic and the relevance of it, I will, on that note, call on Tushima. I'll turn this over to you, and all the best.
Thank you, Anu. Thank you so much. Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining in. I'm really excited, quite buoyed to see the level of interest that this topic has generated and the number of questions that have come in. I've tried to structure the entire session around the main themes that came through in the questions, as well as, you know, some of the areas that I've picked up in the last 20, 25 odd years. So here's how I'm planning to structure today's session. I hope you're seeing my screen.
Yeah, you can put it on slide.
Yes. Perfect. Okay, so there are four parts to today's session. Okay, and there are four keywords in this entire topic. I know it's a fairly long title. So there's leveraging, there's assessments, and there's coaching. And then there's the marketplace. That's today's marketplace. So I'm going to try and touch upon all four of these things and then bring it all together. Like Anu said, keep your questions and comments coming in the chat box. And I'll request Anu, Shweta, if you can just help out and point out any specific question that you think is relevant and stop and just ask me that, so we can keep it free flowing. And at some point, of course, we can open it out and get everyone to join in and interact, so that it can be a fairly lively discussion going forward. And the reason I'm saying this is because I also noticed in the registration list that there are a number of people who have logged in, who have been certified and who have been using several different kinds of psychometrics as part of your work, whether it's coaching or whether it's facilitation or anything else. So I'm sure everyone has got this whole host of different experiences, insights, and so on that you also may want to share, and we can all learn from that. Okay, so with these four things in mind, I think what I'd like to do is start by looking at the most pertinent one, which is the marketplace. Okay, the assessments marketplace has been steadily growing and is really going to grow further. So there is huge appetite today globally for assessments. And when I say assessments, I'm talking about an entire gamut of tools and instruments. So, you know, you have your basic cognitive assessments, which was considered the hallmark of evaluation and assessments not too long ago. But it's amazing to note that in the last 15 to 20 years, the entire thinking around assessments has been completely transformed. So today, corporates, organizations, experts, psychologists, behavioral scientists, organizational psychologists, everyone is pretty clear that cognitive ability is not the primary indicator of how a person will actually perform and behave. So today the thinking is around looking at a person holistically in terms of behavior, personality, their own life experiences, and so on. So the assessment scenario has steadily shifted. And now what I see organizations doing is a beautiful blend of cognitive aptitude, personality assessments, along with fairly intense simulations, which is basically, you know, simulated assessments. And there are several of us over here who have done our fair share of that. I still do it, and it's one of the things that I really love doing. And that's kind of getting complemented with coaching and mentoring. And all of these are actually psychosocial interventions. So globally, the industry is really taking to it and is really taking to it more. Now, if you look at the map that you see on the screen, what you will see is that the entire global market share for assessments, roughly as per these estimates, and this is from Emergent Research, is about $7 billion and is set to grow. APAC is pretty strong. It's a very strong market because it's still not saturated. I would say that North America is probably about 40% of the total market size. And because this has been used so prevalently over there, probably that's why it's in the red and it's been called out as a saturated market, which means that global firms who are really, you know, banking on growing their business through assessments are going to be looking at all the other markets. So we can expect to see a lot more customization and a lot more pitch coming in from consulting firms and from smaller players to offer very high tech and very high quality blended solutions, which will be including assessments. Now, when it comes to India, before the question pops up from anybody, I would say that as per Research and Market, who are a fairly well-known market analyst, the size of the assessment market in India would be about $750 million. So that's where we are now. And there is a fair amount of growth happening in this space. Typically in coaching, what I've seen is coaches work with personality instruments. So the overall general ones as well as specific ones. And I have an entire list that I would love to share with you later. We also do a lot of work with 360 degree feedback. But make no mistake, assessments are everywhere. They are used quite prominently by marketing firms, by marketing departments of organizations. In fact, I have recently come across this website called Psyche. And what they do is they blend your personality as per the big five, and they take those preferences and they actually offer you fashion and apparel choices based on that. So, you know, you dress as per your persona. That's their pitch. And they've been marketing that pretty aggressively. Okay, so assessments are everywhere. Big firms like Mercer, Deloitte, etc. have been talking about it. They've also been acquiring specialized firms who are into assessments. And the recommendation is quite clear that to accelerate your talent and your business going forward, firms are recommending that we use assessments for developing, for hiring, for fitments, and so on and so forth. So that's where we are. Okay. Now, what a typical development journey looks like for a person based on my experiences, usually, and in the past, this is what we would expect, a fairly linear kind of a path where a person starts off, let's say, at point A and then has a smooth, albeit a slightly curved or winding path to wherever he or she finally goes. It could be by default, it could be by design. They may get to where they want to or not. But it used to be a fairly simplistic path. But this is the reality, what you see on the right side. So there are many things that are happening. The development map is a fairly busy one. It's also fairly complex. And a lot of thought is going into it. And it's not really unlike building or putting together a city. So there are many different things that go into it. So in my experience, what I have seen is that there are individuals who have joined organizations, and within the first 10 to 15 years of their careers, they have gone through not just a whole host of learning and development in interventions, but they've also experienced assessments, both, you know, online assessments as well as fairly intense simulated environment assessments or assessment centers. Many of them do also get nominated for other interventions like mentoring and like coaching. Many of the individuals whom I am meeting in assessment centers today have already undergone something like this in the past. And what many of them are doing is actually comparing notes to what was the feedback like earlier and where have they reached now. And I find that the level of candor and introspection and openness that people are coming to these sessions with has absolutely changed over the years. I'm hardly seeing any skepticism, any cynicism. I'm seeing a lot of openness across levels and across age groups. And people are really wanting to discover themselves and get to know themselves better. Yeah, and if there are any questions, any comments that are coming up, Anu, Shweta, I'll just request you to let me know. Otherwise, we'll just keep going.
Okay. Nothing's come to me as yet. So, sure. Shweta, if you have anything, I'm sure we'll pitch in as and when we have something.
Yes, I'll interrupt if I
require. Yeah, thanks. Okay, so what I'm seeing is a big change in terms of moving from a disparate to a connected and integrated framework. So previously, what were we looking at? We were looking at multiple different frameworks and offerings. So everything was not made available to everyone. And there was a fair amount of exclusivity in the way in which developmental solutions and offerings were placed to people. So those of you who are familiar with how companies and organizations work would know that, let's say, learning and development or training is something which everybody got to be a part of. But there were a few people who were, you know, called out as, let's say, high performers or high potential or leadership cadre or people who were earmarked for successions. And they were then put through different kinds of journeys, whether it's an immersion program or whether it's an exchange with another organization or whether it was coaching or mentoring or something else. So there were multiple frameworks. There was some, but not a whole lot of connectivity among them. And the idea was very clear that productivity comes first and development was kind of an add-on. And there was some openness to working on self, even among the people who were considered, you know, the top tier or the top cadre of organizations. Today, what I find is that the thinking has completely changed. And especially in the way things have moved and evolved in the last 2 years, organizations have, I think, realized and have been forced to realize that today, development equals productivity, which means that development needs to come first. And if we want our people to really stay with us and not burn out, we need to start looking at them holistically. So it's there's a lot more integration. And slowly we are moving from a place where we are looking at these kinds of interventions like learning, assessment, coaching, mentoring, whatever it may be. The focus is no longer really on being remedial. So it's no longer on solving a problem. It's no longer on just filling in the gaps. The focus is shifting more and more towards trying to predict. So it's moving from a remedial focus to a more predictive focus. Now with this, we don't really know what the future will hold, and maybe it will be a complete blend of everything, where you may not be able to really distinguish one from the other, but it would still look really aesthetic and beautiful to an outsider. Now with this, I'd really like to ask you, and please feel free to put your answers in the chat box. What are the kind of coaching themes that you see are present among your, dominant among your clients today? And what are the themes which are really emerging as the ones of interest? So let's see what the group says.
Rishima, could you repeat the question?
Yeah, sure. So I'd like to know, what are the coaching themes that are coming up more and more as the current ones and the emerging ones among the people whom you're working with? So I can see some answers coming in. Leading others in crisis, EI, group and team, EQ, career, self-management, holistic development, transitional pains, excellent, systemic coaching. How to stay relevant. Fabulous. So I'm so glad that these are the themes which are coming up, because so here's the reference point. So there is a firm called CoachSource, and they, like many other firms, come up with a fair amount of research and publication every year. If you go through their 2020 global report, they have mentioned exactly some of the themes that you are talking about. And they've also mentioned that the dominant themes that are coming up from clients as well as from organizations. And when I say organizations, I'm not just talking about leadership, but I'm talking about the people who are heading, the coaching or the development or the learning agenda or process in organizations. So the dominant themes are leadership, EI, transitions, like you said. Then there's communication and influencing, which a lot of the individual clients or people who are coming in to be coached are talking about. And very interestingly, executive presence still continues to be this thing of interest. It's very, apparently a very elusive thing. So it still continues to elude all of us, and people are quite interested in figuring out how to develop executive presence going forward. So these are really the dominant themes that are coming across. And organizations are blending different kinds of interventions more and more going forward. Work-life balance, yes. Work-life balance, mental health. A lot of organizations are talking about mental health. Behaviors, collaboration, yes. Yes. So see, a lot of the older themes, like let's say focusing on strategy or the pure play communication and presentation, critical thinking or analytical thinking, many of the abilities which were considered to be more cognitive, I'm not seeing them in your list, and I'm not seeing them in any list, in any other new list either. It doesn't mean that they're not important. What this is indicating is that people are more and more capable of solving their problems if first they can figure out what the problem or what the challenge actually is. So I think a lot of people who are coming in into coaching scenarios today are interested in actually discovering and figuring out what is it that they should be focusing on. And that's where I see assessments playing an important critical role in accelerating that thinking and identification process. okay. So during registration, if you remember, we asked you what assessments do you use? Okay, so here it is. Hogan seems to be a fairly common and popular one. And I do remember somebody had mentioned in the comments that although coaches may be certified on many other things, organizations are also pretty interested in working with Hogan assessments. And if you know you have any comments, any questions in terms of talking about why companies or why you tend to prefer certain types of assessments, you know, I'd love to hear that. MBTI is an old-time classical instrument, and it's a pleasant surprise to see that it's still in use by so many of our coaches here. 360 degree. Now, this is really interesting because a 360 degree is assessment is something which is not offered as a pure play research-backed assessment, right? So different organizations have their own version of 360 degree. And more often than not, this is mapped to a specific set of competencies. So it's very different from all the other assessments that you have. Some of the newer assessments that we're hearing about are the Enneagram, then the VIA character strengths, which are, one is primarily looking at different worldviews. The VIA character strengths is a positive psychology tool. And of course you have things like the DISC, Firo B. Harrison. So it's a very interesting mix of trait-based as well as type-based assessments. And we're going to look at some of these a little more in detail as we go forward.
Tushima, before you go ahead, yes. There's a question here.
Yes.
Asking if Enneagram is used by corporates in India.
Good question. I don't see, Gauri has asked this question. Gauri, I don't see an Enneagram being used much by corporates in India. And I'm really not aware of all the empirical research that's gone into creating the Enneagram. I find that it's used more by coaches themselves. And I think probably they are the ones who are bringing it to the table. What corporates really seem to be favoring are exactly what Arvind has put in the chat box. Hogan, 360 degree, maybe even some team-based or group-based assessments. Yeah, Rajan, I'm aware that there are issues and there are questions around the reliability and validity with Enneagram. Okay, Dr. Reddy's, you are using Enneagram. Well, that's surprising. Hogan, OPQ, 360 degree, Strength Finder. Yes, these have been in use consistently for some time. Yes. Okay. So in your view, if you can just put in just one word, or those of you who are using assessments and who do think that it's good to use assessments in coaching, what's your primary reason really for using assessments in your coaching practice? Starting point, self-reflection, self-discovery. Yeah, what else? Strengths and opportunities. Empirical data. Excellent point, Mohan. Primary reason and referencing, yes. Yes, great conversation starters. Discovery, direction, yeah. So a lot of agenda setting input seems to be coming in from assessments, I guess at the start of the coaching journey, and also at any other point during the coaching journey, to facilitate things like reflection, awareness, insight, creating more avenues of exploration and discussion. Okay, so here's my little cheat sheet or list. Of all the benefits that I see individual coaches, practitioners, organizational stakeholders talking about in terms of why assessment. So like you said, Mohan, and some of you also indicated, it's the empirical evidence which forms the foundation or the body of work around assessments that really makes it a preferred choice for a lot of organizations. as well as practitioners today, right? And these are the strong four psychometric principles. It's reliable, it's valid, it's standardized, and there's freedom from bias. And when I say freedom from bias, I mean that it's probably been tested for the relevance in different geographies, cultures, age groups, and so on. So the moment a tool is known for doing that, then it kind of tends to get adopted really well globally, right? Professional guidance. A lot of assessments come with specific requirements around, you know, licensing, certification. So for many of these, you need to go through some kind of a training program to be able to understand and accurately use, administer, as well as interpret the result. So there's a fair amount of guidance as well as governance around how these are used, and clients and organizations like that. The assessments, which are quite popular, are also fairly easy to use. So, you know, they're really user friendly in terms of the look and feel, the way that they are administered. A lot of the reports are visual. And I find this is a great selling point, although coaches don't really talk about it much. I'm looking at it from the point of view of the recipient of the assessment, which is the client. So if you look at some of the reports that are available today, they are aesthetically made and pleasing. They're written out in fairly, you know, with fairly clear structures. They're quite self-explanatory, which makes the coach's job that much easier. You need to spend less time explaining, you know, the why of it, and straight away get into looking at what are the insights, you know, and what's the treasure that's really coming out of the assessment, rather than trying to break your heads around what does this chart mean and what does the graph mean and so on. Intelligence for inclusion. Now, this is something which I think there's a lot of scope for organizations to leverage further going on. And by this, what I really mean is that looking at the different personality profiles that are there in an organization gives the organization the intelligence that it needs to make more relevant and customized inclusion agendas. So we're all talking about diversity, inclusion, equity, and so on and so forth. And there's a lot of focus now on working on diversity of thought, diversity of personality, diversity of different kinds of people. And if you look at your psychometric profiles, it really gives you enough data to tell you what are the differences really that we are talking about that we ought to be embracing. Of course, increased awareness, many of you spoke about. I would say that for a coach who is really adept and who is really skilled at using assessments, it's a great leverage point for building your own trust and credibility with your clients. And for clients, of course, I see that it creates a lot of additional clarity and confidence about who they are, being okay with how they are, and really figuring out where they want to go. So there's a lot of value in it for different stakeholders. And what you see at the bottom of the screen is an excerpt from a client in terms of how he experienced the entire assessment process that was done. And where I find assessments probably are received with a lot of positivity and surprise are clients who have never gone through something like this before. So it's really eye-opening, and it can be quite mind-boggling to see the kind of insights that a person can get out of a process like a blend of assessment and coaching, and they really receive it with a lot of gratitude. So let's look at the intersection of coaching and assessments. I think there were quite a few questions that came in during the registration, that what are the different scenarios where you can actually apply assessments in your coaching. So let's again hear from the group. Where do you use assessments in your coaching?
Tushima, while we wait for the responses, do you want to take some questions?
Yeah, sure.
So one question that's relevant to the section that we just covered is from Ajay Goel, who's saying that he read a post
On LinkedIn. On LinkedIn.
Yes. Have you read that question?
Yes. I think I may have read that post as well. Ajay, thank you for pointing that out. I'm actually not aware that ICF has really taken a stance that coaches should not use assessments. And if they have, then I really wonder why. Well, the fact is that all of us who are going through any kind of a credentialing certification process to be coaches or to be practitioners anywhere are also putting ourselves through an assessment process, right? We're putting ourselves through exams, we are putting ourselves through being assessed, being observed, and so on. And that's also an assessment. Probably what Gauri is saying is valid, that it has cautioned against the mismanagement of assessments. Yes. So assessments, like any other psychosocial intervention, must be used with the right kind of perspective, maturity, and care, which means that we need to be careful how it is being explained to the client in terms of what is this assessment really all about, what can it do, what can it not do. So the fact that it is more an indication of a person's preference and not really a test of proficiency, especially when you look at personality assessments. Yes, Srikant, why would they discourage assessments? I do agree with you. So how an assessment is used, Kim, you're right, how it is used is definitely important. Yeah, Gauri, you've raised your hand. You want to say something?
Yeah, may I?
Yeah.
Thank you, Toshima. There was another post, incidentally, by the head of an L&D of a very well-known Indian firm, and she used Hogan to say, we hired a person.
Yeah.
And I remember the words in it. Her demands were off the charts and we had to let her go and blah, blah, blah. And, you know, that relates to what Rajat Garg's post was saying, that you cannot base your hiring decision or the entirety of it on the assessment that you're using. You can use it as a handrail. But a lot of organizations tend to do this. They say they put the blame on the assessment or the psychometric that they used. So I think where Rajat was coming from is there needs to be a lot more nuanced understanding of what that report is telling you about a person. And if you're going to make a decision, then it's your own. It's not what the psychometric is telling you. So I kind of related to both these posts when you said, you know, we need to be careful when we are using assessments.
Yes, yes, absolutely. So there have been several instances in my own experience during interactions with people when we are discussing their psychometric profiles, and people are pretty direct in asking the question, what do you see in me? Or what are the defects? What are my areas of strength? What do you think I am weak on? And these questions are all being directed at me, keeping the personality profile as a reference. I think it's very important for administrators and practitioners who work with assessments to really clarify that, in very simple terms, that we cannot hold a person's personality and preference against them. And I absolutely agree that it would not be right to use a tool and say that this is the basis on which I've made this decision. And if the decision doesn't really go my way, then to say that, well, the tool didn't work for me. Because in a sense, what I'm really doing is I'm outsourcing my entire decision-making capability into the hands of a tool. Now, what comes out in a psychometric or in a personality profile, we have to keep in mind is basically a self-reporting exercise, right? So the individual is not being observed in the psychometric test. You get the test, you enter the responses, a report and a result gets generated, and then you get a snapshot or a profile of what your preferences are against different kind of traits, or what are, you know, the most dominant typologies or themes which are present in the way in which you are likely to come across. And note my words here. the way in which you are likely to come across. It in no way tells you that this is how you definitely are, and or you will be good at this. And I would really, really caution against doing something like that. So thank you very much, Ajay, for bringing that question up.
Yeah, if one doesn't like what one sees in the mirror, probably the mirror can't be blamed. Thank you for saying that, Nimesh. Okay, so coming back to my question, and I'm talking about this specifically because there were a lot of questions that came in the registration as to when do you actually introduce or how do assessments actually fit in the larger scheme of things. So let's take three different scenarios, okay? So let's look at leadership development, which as all of you said is quite a dominant theme. So when it comes to leadership development, what I see organizations doing is definitely a mix of different things. So it's no longer just parallel activities, but for a lot of their people at across levels, I'm not just talking about senior levels, but even at the level of emerging leaders, they would have a hybrid program. And I say program, I'm not talking about a 2 or 3 day intervention. It could easily be something that lasts from 6 to about 9 or even 12 months. And these are all leadership journeys that are very carefully curated. They do have elements of assessment, sometimes pre and post the entire activity. The assessment could be of different types. It could be a self-assessment by the person, where the individual talks about where they were and where they are now. It could also be input that is co-opted from their colleagues, from their managers, and so on. There is a fairly healthy input of learning. And when I say learning, it would not just be workshops, but there could be other assignments, strategic projects that people work on. So it's a mix of, you know, learning on the job as well as learning from others. Those of you who are familiar with the 70-20-10 model would know that there's a lot of focus on this, on in terms of learning on the job, learning from others, as well as learning by oneself. And of course, there is coaching. There could also be mentoring, which may be offered along with all of these. And there is ample scope to bring in assessments pre as well as post. Let's take another scenario, capability or career building. This is also a fairly popular theme with a lot of individual clients as well as organizations who are really wanting to accelerate their skills and capability map. So here, coaching may actually focus on building certain specific skills or competencies, capabilities, behaviors in people, which they themselves would identify with some input from the organization. So in some of the engagements that I have done, the individual talks about what it is that they want, but the sponsor always has an agenda. And then what we finally come up with, and everybody agrees on that, is a blend of the two. So here assessments can be used to actually inform the goal setting process, or even sometimes after let's say the initial 3 or 4 sessions, when it's, you know, when the engagement is becoming more intense, and the person is really ready to do some more deep diving into, you know, where they're going, what are the other avenues that they want to start exploring, and so on. And it really depends on the appetite of the individual as well as the organization as to how much of reflection and insight that they want to do. So your choice of assessment tool can really be dictated by how much of depth and how many dimensions are people really wanting to explore. Okay. And the third scenario is where all of you who are working with a lot of individual clients or people maybe even working at senior levels who are just in the coaching journey, not for executive or career purposes, but for what is popularly known as life coaching, where the focus is mainly on self. And here there is ample opportunity and a lot of flexibility of the kind of different assessment tools that you use. Okay, there were also a couple of questions that came up in the registration on pricing. So I'm very curious to know if you're willing to share that, according to you, what's your preference? Would you rather price it separately? Would you bundle it along with your entire coaching offering? Bundle. Separate, okay. Yes, so somebody mentioned very correctly that whatever it is, transparent, very transparently state the component. And I would completely agree with that. So if there is an opportunity to leverage it and to bundle it upfront, then by all means, go ahead and do so. If you're not sure at the start of the journey whether you are going to be needing an assessment, it's still good to state in the contract that at some point, if we mutually agree to do this, then you know it's going to be priced separately. And the reason I'm stating this is because I have seen a couple of articles and blogs about people who are on the receiving end of coaching, who are kind of cautioning the others that, you know, find out what are the real costs at the start of the journey so that you don't get hit with additional costs for assessments later. So it's always a good practice for coaches to be completely transparent and state upfront whether the price includes the assessment or if you use it later, you're going to be adding it on separately. Okay, Shweta, I'll need your help. I think there were some previous comments on maybe different aspects which I have missed out.
So there are some questions. You can let us know whether this is the right time to go through it.
Let's do that.
So Gauri had asked a question saying, what's your view on the contemporary organizational assessments being pulled into coaching? Glint, for instance, makes amazing reports on engagement pulse surveys.
Sorry, can you just repeat that?
Yeah, so sorry.
A little slowly, because I'm not able to read the comment.
Right, no, it was way ahead. Okay. So the question is, what's your view on the contemporary organizational assessments being pulled into coaching? And Glint, for instance, makes amazing reports on engagement pulse surveys. Gauri, if you want to elaborate on the question, please feel free to unmute and share your thoughts.
Thanks, Shweta. Kushima, Glint is a Palo Alto company that's now been bought over by LinkedIn. It kind of goes with the contemporary philosophy that you cannot be measuring the perceptions of a leader once in a whole year. It's too late to be launching a coaching engagement with some data that is so, you know, 9 month old, 10 month old. So Glint does pulse surveys. In Singapore, I use that with a lot of clients, but here I wanted to ask you, has it entered? Have you used Glint for launching coaching engagements for any leaders? Has that penetrated the coaching sphere here in India?
No, I haven't. But what I do see is, Gauri, rather than engagement, I find that 360 becomes a fairly popular and likely source at which an organization may want to initiate coaching or some other intervention. Because they, you know, more and more, this is the feedback that they are taking very seriously, because the theme of collaboration has become an absolute, I would say, driver of survival for organizations. It's no longer a good to have thing. So today it's a must. And therefore the 360 degree feedback is taken a lot more seriously.
Yeah, but it's still 1 year old data, remember? And we are in this VUCA world with pandemic and things changing every third month, where we are in lockdown, where we are not. And all those things are affecting the leadership level. So I was hoping that somewhere you may have seen Glint, because I'm definitely pushing it now with Indian clients. I'm saying 360 is too old. It's too long, too late. And I think I put a link there. The moment people start seeing what Glint can do, then they're like, okay, 360 really feels dated. So I thought it might come in handy for coaches, you know, themselves.
Yeah, so definitely if there's a tool which I think which works faster and which is more adaptive and which is able to give that kind of data and insight, both quantitative as well as qualitative, better than a 360, then companies may be opting for that. But I've also seen a lot of organizations are adding 360 to the entire assessment scenario. So along with all the other assessments, simulations, they're also looking at the immediate stakeholder feedback. And the cycle time for 360 has actually shrunk. So it's no longer taking as long for organizations to do that, because consulting firms have also become they've also come on board fairly fast. They're able to link the two competency frameworks pretty fast, roll out the 360 quickly. And it becomes, quite a common part of the debrief process. But if Glint is able to do something better, faster, and there could be others. I know GLA 360 has also been trying to enter the market for some time. But yeah, this space is definitely going to pick up and there's going to be more competition. Tanmay.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, Gauri. Tanmay, you've raised your hand.
Yeah, because I was not able to understand why the assessment that 360 always takes 1 year, because even 30-40 people participating in a 360, a 360 can be done in 2 weeks. So I was not able to understand why she was referring 360 is 1 year old, 360 is 1 year old. 360 can be done in a matter of 2 weeks, right?
Yeah.
Can be done is very different from whether it's available when the leader
then, has then you need the another future. Organization change, because if the organization need 1 year to do assessment, that means that organization will go out of business very soon.
I would disagree, because I have three CXOs and they don't have their recent 45-day-old 360s. So we've had to figure out other things. So I can tell you that it does pose challenges when you like suddenly want to start a coaching engagement, because I think coaching engagements which begin after an assessment center or a development center are pretty calendarized. But there are times when you, like, for example, I'm coaching a leader who's taken on the P&L for US, and it's an Indian pharma company, and he didn't have assessment center reports, 360 reports, psychometric reports. So I had to come up with something else. So for those kind of engagements I have faced in India, no 360s available, like a 45-day-old 360.
Request if we can take this conversation offline, that the others' interests are kept in consideration. Tushima, I'll go ahead with the next question.
Yes.
I think there was one more question from you, Gauri, on what's your take on using DISC for coaching? Tushima, if you have any views, or will you be covering that later?
Yeah, we'll come to that later. Thanks.
Great. And then there's one more question from Sunita Sinha.
Yeah, Sunita.
Coaches sometimes use assessment as a report card. What are your thoughts on the statement, and what's the correct combination of usage, if you want to add anything?
Yeah, sure. So, somehow in my mind, the words coaching and report card don't really go together. So, I'm really not in, I don't think I would be in favor of, coaches or anybody else looking at an assessment either as a report card or as a scorecard. What it is really meant to be is actually kind of like another mirror or another angle. And here, I'd like to quote from an excellent article which was written by Dr. Ajay Behl on LinkedIn. It's available for everybody to read. And he talks about the phenomenological approach to coaching. And what he's really talking about is that this approach to coaching, and I feel that's very relevant to the use of assessments, is really about sense making on two levels. And it works best in coaching scenarios where the client is wanting to work on something that they themselves have not really figured out and understood well enough. So for example, when a client says that there's something missing or there's a missing piece, I don't know quite what it is, but I know that this is a journey, that a road that I definitely want to go down. And it will be nice to work with somebody to help me figure out what is it that I really want to focus on? Why is this important to me? And is there anything in that to do? They may not be able to put a name to it. They may not be able to describe it, but it's a fairly strong feeling. And a lot of the unknown areas are really what I think a good assessment tool and a really strong debrief in the hands of an expert coach can really unravel for them, because it's those points of discovery that really become a delight for the client. So he's talking about sense making on two levels, where the client is trying to make sense of the thought that is in their minds, or the issue that they've still not been able to get a grip on. And the coach's job there is not to make sense of the issue, but rather to make sense of the person and keep reflecting it back to them. So this is a scenario in which I think assessment is the most useful. I do not see it as a report card. It's not a test where I tell somebody that, you know, look, you, you know, you made it or you didn't. Because the fact is that there is no right or wrong. There is no good or bad. There is no best personality or best fit or best type of profile. And this is really what makes each person so unique and wonderful. And I also find a lot of openness on the part of the individual clients to really explore that, because there are a lot of people who are also trying to make sense of themselves and are coming to the table with that. And if the coach is able to create the right kind of trust and transparency, and, you know, then the credibility of the entire coaching and engagement really goes up. So I really hope, Sunita, I answered your question. If you have a follow-up or you have a different point of view, do let me know. Ashweta, are there any other questions at this point?
Tushma, they are all assessment-specific questions. So do you want to take them later?
Yeah, we can do that. And, you know, probably we can use the remaining 15 minutes also for everyone to just pitch in and talk about, you know, what you think of different types of assessments. Sure. And I think that's a conversation we can kind of keep going. Okay, there's a question from Nandita. From a pricing and reliability point of view, which tool is best suited for life coaching? Okay, good. So Nandita, I'll just request you to just park this question, because I have a list. It's by no means an exhaustive list, but we can talk about that later. Okay. So when it comes to selecting the right assessments, all right, let me remove this. Let's understand from everyone here, what are the one or two things which you would definitely look at or consider when you're selecting the right assessments? What criteria have you adopted so far in making your own selection for assessments? And this was also a question that prominently featured in the registration questions. Effective, practical, organizational, is there a need for it? Evidence-based and trusted by industry, objective, depends on the issue, yeah, the context, speed, cost. Great. Agree with all the points that have come in so far. So I would really put it, I would really put the criteria into three different kinds of buckets. So there are indicators with respect to the organization. There are indicators with respect to what I call the right fit, which is the actual tool. And then there's something which I refer to as the perspective of the coach. When it comes to organizational indicators, I put them basically into four different primary indicators to select assessments. Firstly, what's the context? Why is an assessment required? So by no means am I advocating that assessments are a must and they should be used it becomes part and parcel of any kind of every single coaching intervention. No, I think if there is a real way in which you find that an assessment is relevant to that context, maybe it hasn't been tried before. Probably there are a lot of unasked questions. If there is a lot of room for really delving into different aspects of the individual's psyche, then yeah, it's a fairly ripe setting to introduce, to bring assessment into the conversation. Secondly, the contract.
And by the contract, and by contract, I mean not just whether you have, you know, you've contracted to do an assessment with the client, but I mean, what's the psychological contract that you have with the organization and with the client? Is there really appetite and is there openness to doing assessments? That's one. Secondly, to what level are people really wanting to get into this? What's the appetite? Like I said earlier, I work with assessment with coaching clients who don't really have the bandwidth and who do not have the appreciation and the interest at that point in time to do an assessment and really get that much amount of data and make the most of it. But 3-4 months down the line that they are ready. So there's a written contract and there's an unspoken contract. And the verbal or the unspoken contract is really much, much, much more important. So if you do have a contract of exploration, then by all means, go for it. Relevance. By relevance, I'm not referring to, is assessment relevant in that context? But the reality is that all coaches are not certified or trained on all assessments. So a few of us are trained on 3, 4, 5. Some of us are trained on 1, 2, and so on and so forth. So is the tool that we are proficient with really relevant in that scenario or not? If not, then you know who else can be trained on it? So do you want to bring in somebody else if you feel that a different tool will work better, but you or me, whoever is the coach, does not really have the expertise or the credential to bring that in? And appetite, I've already covered. Okay. When it comes to right fit, I think the first thing to consider is the alignment. How congruent or how aligned is the use of a particular assessment tool with the organization's own business context, the culture in which they're operating in? And two, how well do the use of assessments actually fit in with the clients or with the coach's own domain expertise? So how integral is it or how natural is it to your practice to use assessments? For some coaches, it is very natural. It's part and parcel of what they do. And for others, it's a very deliberate, informed decision. So I would say that the number one rule here is that it should feel right to the coach to use an assessment, because your own conviction somewhere tends to come through. And if you're not 100% convinced that you should be doing this assessment, or that this is the right tool to do it, or this is the right way to do it, then that will definitely be visible to your client. Okay. Some of the other factors like assessments, tools should be standardized, evidence-backed, and so on, I've already covered. What I really want to also talk about is the process and the report. Okay, so how easy is it? How quick is it? What's the user experience like? As far as possible, it should be technology enabled. You know, the confidentiality of the entire administration of the assessment should really be watertight. There should be no questions asked. There should be no room for any kind of doubt of how the assessment was administered. And what's the longevity or shelf life? Now, this I find is usually a great selling point of a good assessment, is that the worth or the value of the assessment continues long after the coaching or the learning or whatever the engagement is over. So if you have a client who really appreciates and who you know is going to go back to the report later to get more insights, and they're going to appreciate it, then it becomes a good reason to actually work with an assessment. And when it comes to perspective, I would say that there are things which really matter a lot beyond the assessment tool, beyond knowing the assessment. One is the coach's own understanding of the business and the context. Second is this aspect of expertise. Now, for me, I find that it's fairly easy to use and apply assessment in different scenarios because I have the advantage of probably, you know, I've had the opportunity to explore the body of psychology also somewhere in the past. And somehow I know how an assessment fits in with the theory, with the psychology, what it says, what are the pros and cons, which are the things that I can definitely count on
where are the questions, where is there room for doubt? And what I mean by that is my expertise allows me to exercise discretion in a really mature way, which is what really helps me not hold a person's report against them and to not really label the individual based on what the assessment report is saying. And there are a lot of coaches who also believe that some knowledge of the science behind the assessment is definitely required. So an appreciation of psychology or of the body of work that is behind the assessment is also very important in order to be able to really administer it and talk about it in the right way. So the coach's own expertise, knowledge, and maturity plays a huge role here. I'm just going to pause here. Shweta, are there any questions or any comments that have come in?
No questions on this particular topic.
Okay. Thanks. Okay, we're going to move on. Right, there were a lot of questions that came in earlier on the use of XYZ type of assessments. And I've looked at, you know, what everybody else works with. And I've also looked at a lot of lists that practitioners and experts have published. And the one thing that is immediately obvious to anyone who's done, you know, a net search on this for even 30 minutes is that everybody's list is different. So whenever anyone talks about assessments or which are the, you know, the most favored ones or which are the common ones, you'll find that there are a lot of differences in this list. I'm sure that there are many assessments that you're thinking of which you may not be looking at here. And this is just an indicative list, because what I've tried to do is to look at different assessments tagged to different theories or assumptions of or bodies of work. By and large, people do know that there are assessments which are primarily of, you know, two different categories, trait-based and type-based. But the fact is that there are many different theories or assumptions around these. If you have questions as to, you know, which one is what, I'll be happy to do that, or we can do it at the end. But my main takeaway, what I'm talking about here is in the first box, which is computerized and adaptive. So the rise of the computerized adaptive personality assessment is really the next big thing or the current big thing. For example, the US Army uses something called TAPAS, which is the Tailored Adaptive Personality Assessment. Then of course, AON uses ADEPT, some of you may be familiar with, and they do refer to it as the world's most advanced computerized adaptive personality tool. So what is so great about an adaptive and computerized personality assessment tool? For one, it's extremely easy to administer. So there's no paper and pencil at all. It's completely computerized. Privacy, confidentiality, security, etc. is completely taken care of. And the beauty of the tool is that it's adaptive. So like many of the other exams or tests that you may have taken, the questions actually change in the assessment depending on your previous answers. So the tool is constantly adapting to your responses and checking for the strength of your preferences. And what this does is that it ensures, one, that it's, I would say, nearly impossible for you to actually manipulate the tool or do something which is inconsistent with your natural style, because the inconsistency then also comes up really strongly. And that becomes a good point of this discussion between the person who's doing the debrief and the individual. Secondly is, because it's computerized and adaptive, it moves fairly fast. Thirdly is the algorithm is pretty strong and watertight, and it's really, really consistent. So the reliability, validity is pretty high on these kinds of assessments. And these are on the rise, especially in a virtual work setting, because it's no longer a face-to-face interaction. And sponsors as well as clients want to be absolutely sure that if they're really allowing themselves to be seen and sharing information about who they are and how they are, then the entire setup has to be really confidential and, you know, with the right kind of governance. So I find that there's a lot of trust and there's a lot of use of the computerized testing today. Okay. Okay, there are assessments used for very specific purposes also. So the ones that we've looked at earlier are based on overall theories of personality, where you can look at a whole host of different aspects in one's personality, psyche, worldview, how will we like to do things, and so on and so forth. But there are some really specific ones. Okay, and I've listed them here. So emotional intelligence is a fairly common and popular theme. Self-efficacy is based on the work done by Dr. Albert Bandura, who is one of the most respected and highly reputed psychologists there has ever been. Not sure how many of you have used the growth mindset scale. It's fairly simple. It's based on Carol Dweck's work. The learning style inventory also is a great way, especially when you're looking at exploring how a person would like their entire development approach to be like. Okay. Then there are assessments specifically for team roles, for different kinds of teams. I don't know what the group's experience is in using FIROB with teams, but in general, in the past, it has been used along with MBTI, so like a complementary interpersonal as well as intrapersonal. Fearless organization is also a tool which is now becoming popular. It's primarily used to look at the level of psychological safety in a team, which is of growing interest to individuals as well as organizations, and so on. Some of these, you know, require certification and accreditation and so on. Some of them are open source, so they're available. You can use it, you can download it, you can score it, and there's really no cost. They've made it available to everybody, but it's still reliable, valid, and backed by a reasonably strong body of research and work. I know, yes, there's even a humor styles quotient for you to find out what is your preferred style of humor. So there are all kinds of assessments out there. Okay, are there any questions at this point?
Do you want to take the assessment specific questions now?
Yeah, we can look at them. I don't know how many of them I will actually be able to answer, but I'm going to do my best. So tell me.
Sure. So I think Gauri has raised her hand, and Gauri had also asked a question on what's your take on DISC for coaching? So if you'd like to start there.
Yeah.
Actually, you know, because time is limited, I want you to ask you, Toshima, ethics is very grossly underspoken of when we talk of assessments. And my experience has been that in India, when we ask people to share their personality traits or responses to situations, unless it's organizationally conducted, rarely have I seen the reports going out, especially with hiring and CXO, because we're talking of Kogan. In a lot of CXO hiring positions, because of the derailers report, I feel that it's a very missed topic, because it's data privacy on the one hand, and second, you are recording somebody's responses and psychometric notes. So please, can you talk about that? Because I think this topic never gets covered anywhere.
Yes, well, like I'd mentioned earlier, Gauri, that there are some of these assessments which come with strict professional guidance in terms of, you know, the training, the certification, and the governance. And I find that probably earlier, the ethics component did not get emphasized to that extent. But today, it definitely is. And that happens in two ways. One is, you know, by the firm that is making the assessment available to the practitioner. But secondly, I also find that more and more, those of us who are signing up to be coaches, either with organizations, or if you're signing up to be coaches in an empanelment, we automatically become signatories to their code of conduct. There is a confidentiality clause, there is an ethics clause. So how we conduct ourselves, what we say, how it is interpreted, I find that there is a fair amount of understanding, at least at the level of, you know, the really top and well-known firms and top coaches and clients who are from organizations where they themselves have a strong code of ethics. So I find that there is growing sensitivity in people around this. what you're saying is probably true of the past, but I find that things are definitely changing, and there are clear expectations of how coaches, assessors, practitioners, trainers, etc. are expected to conduct themselves. So which is why I mentioned the point on inclusion. We are also expected to be quite inclusive in the way in which we conduct ourselves, and we have to be really careful that when we are doing debriefs, or you know, when we are giving feedback, or when we are doing coaching conversations, we really cannot be playing to the biases and stereotypes that are there in our own mind. So it's really good if, as a coach, when you're using an assessment, that you go through it yourself, because the coach's awareness is a first step to the coach enabling awareness for anybody else. So that's my take on that.
Thank you.
Thanks.
So the next question we have is from Tanmay Das. What would be your favorite assessments for leadership agility?
Okay, leadership agility. What is leadership agility, Tanmay?
Okay, you can just answer leadership.
Okay, I can just answer leadership.
There is another component to it, Nima. It is the vertical development, because we're in the VUCA world, right?
Yeah.
So vertical development become very important. So going back to, it's like Robert Keegan, Bill Torbert's work, and Bill Joyner have came up with leadership agility. And there is also leadership 360 by Leadership Circle, which also talks about vertical development. So my question is more towards which leadership assessment that addresses vertical development, which be your favorite tool for Salesforce? Source.
Yeah. So then I guess what really comes out of what you're saying, Tanmay, is what are the leadership behaviors of the future, therefore, that we are looking at, and which assessment tool looks at these?
Yes.
So yeah. So then in my view, rather than looking at only specific instruments on, you know, let's say empathy, listening, and so on, which are all important behaviors for today and the future, I would rather look at the broader tools. So, you know, Hogan, Adept, Harrison assessments, coupled with something like, let's say, a 360, because it's what we're really talking about when we say leadership is not just about how people see themselves, which is what's inside, but also how they are viewed outside, which is reputation, which is a very important, you know, which is what all these tools are really all about. And it's really fascinating that although it's completely based on your response, but ultimately the report tells you about how you are likely to be viewed by others. So when you talk about yourself, you're actually revealing how the world might be viewing you. So broad-based tools, which cover an entire gamut of different kinds of behaviors, to my mind, would be probably good tools to look at a leadership development scenario, because it gives the leader or the individual, the flexibility to pick and choose specific aspects that they feel are more relevant. So it's not about the coach telling them that, okay, these are the leadership behaviors, you know, which are important, and therefore let's only study these. So let's give a lot of options, and then you choose what you think is really going to move you forward in future. Does that answer your question, Tanmay?
Partially, but I'm not sure if Hogan and Harrison is covering the aspect of vertical development.
Okay. So if there's anybody else in the group who knows something which covers vertical development, feel free to pitch in.
Tanmay Gauri here. What do you mean by vertical development? Promotions? Global?
No, sorry. I need to now debrief. See, horizontal development means you are picking up skills and competences. Vertical development, I think Tunima said a little bit, it's phenomenology. How you see, what kind of vantage point you have when you are seeing a complex situation. That means the more mature the leader becomes on the vertical scale, the leader can actually handle more complexity and more ambiguity.
So why wouldn't Hogan work in this? I mean, it has quite a few brilliant data.
So quite a few.
Harrison too.
I would say EQ also. MSC EIT, which covers an entire gamut of different kinds of emotional maturity behaviors, would also work.
Even the 360, you know, because it tells you where the person is faltering. What are his vertical development in the organization is about? what your team thinks of you, what your boss thinks of you, where your stakeholders see you going, you know, if you continue doing what you're doing. And 360 does just fine. It, it gives you a lot of inputs.
Yeah, it does.
It's how you interpret, which is everything with assessments at the end of the day.
And apart from all this, so, you know, I find that many of the cognitive and the affective, which is the feeling-based aspects, tend to get covered really well across different tools. But there is something called the Kolbe A profile. I'm not sure, you know, what the group's take on that is, but I've used it even for myself. It's very interesting. It covers something called the cognitive part of the mind or thinking, and which is basically about how we like to act. So it tells you what is your preferred instinctive way of acting or doing things. And acting or doing things is a big part of a leader's life. So what you actually say, how you present, how you would rather explain things, what you tend to get more excited about in any kind of activity. Is it ideas? Is it demonstrating things? Is it actually doing things? So that's also a good tool to use, according to me. Okay, in the interest of time, with your permission, I will move on. Shweta, unless there's something.
There are a few more questions on selecting the right assessment tool.
Okay, so, then let's
yeah, there's that. One question from Anbu on what's your thoughts on leadership circle?
On leadership?
Circle.
Okay, leadership circle. Good question. Total disclosure, I haven't used it.
Okay, so I'll move on to the next question then. There's a question from Nandita from a pricing and reliability point of view.
Yes.
Which tool is best suited for life coaching?
Okay. So again, I guess Nandita, here it depends on whether you're using it with an individual or whether you're using it with a corporate. Or rather, I would say that what's really the price constraint here is my question. And I think there a bundled approach works really well, because if you really look at the total assessment cost and you divide that by the total number of sessions you're going to be doing with a person, then almost any assessment then becomes fine to use. If you're talking specifically about life coaching, then you know it's good to look at the ones which allow for really deep exploration and insight, and which are more broad based. So if you want to delve more into how I am with others, then you could look at something like, let's say, a Firobee. But if you really want to look at, you know, what's my own worldview or how do I see myself, then you could even look at something like the self-efficacy scale, which is really about beliefs. How much do I believe that I can grow? What is my own belief about myself? Or what kind of growth mindset do I have? Or even some of the broad-based ones like the OPQ or the DISC or Harrison, because all of these are empirically backed. If it's strengths-based coaching, which is really your forte and comes naturally to you, then you could look at scales like the character strengths or the grit scale. And as of now, these are available just to be used at no cost. I've used them a lot with many people. They're all good to be used according to me. If you want one which is backed by a classical theory, then of course Big Five is a very safe bet, because it's really broad and there's enormous room for exploration over there. So I hope I answered your question, Nandita.
There was also a follow-on question on emotional intelligence from Nandita.
Yeah.
I think that's answered in the slide.
Yes. Yeah. So, so EI, EQ, these are actually growing areas of interest. I think we will see more happening on this, more different kinds of tools, instruments. Probably there could be separate add-ons on emotional intelligence that existing assessments may start offering.
In the same context, there's a question from Sunanda. What is the best tool when coaching outside of the organization context?
Okay. I would say it depends purely on what the coaching themes are. So when one is coaching outside of the organization, which means it's purely a non-corporate or a non-organizational context, then it's, I think it's important to first establish what are the themes that you want to focus on and what's the appetite of the individual to really delve into the assessment and pick up cues from there. So I have used Hogan as assessments even with individuals outside of the organizational context. And I found a lot of value in that. I've used VIA character strengths and I found a lot of value in that. And they're quite different in their approaches. But I apply my discretion to see what kind of tool is likely, you know, to really create that kind of trust and acceptance and excitement in the individual. How much time are they actually likely to invest in completing the assessment process, in reading the report along with me? Because as a coach or as a practitioner, you don't really want to be in a situation where you are more excited and enthusiastic about an individual's personality profile than him or her. You would really want it, you know, to be at on par, or you would want the other person to be far more enthusiastic and to really come up with, you know, questions, insights, and use it and really own it. So that's a very, very, very big factor, according to me.
Great. And we have one more tool specific question. Yeah. Do we have any assessment tool for executive presence? This is from Ajay Goyal.
Yeah, Ajay. You know, the thing is, I think there is no consistent or common description of executive presence in the first place. There are so many different interpretations. There are so many different versions. I'm sure if you ask five different people in the group to describe it, we would see five different definitions. So even if there is a tool, I would really hesitate to go along with it. I would first want to understand what is the individual's definition of executive presence, and then actually map that to something which is covered, which is more specific, right? And this really brings me to this interesting phenomena called the Barnum effect. Not sure if, you know, if everyone's familiar with it or you have come across it. But the Barnum effect is really a term which is used to describe a phenomenon where you read a description about yourself in a particular aspect and you find that it's completely accurate and, you know, you totally agree with it. But the catch is that it's written in very vague and generic terms, and it could really be true of anybody. But we feel that it's so true of us. And this, according to me, also becomes a very important criteria for selecting a strong assessment tool. Because unless the reporting is really specific and talks about specific aspects, specific actions that a person is likely to do, I would then just prefer to stay away from it. Because if we don't get concrete specific insights from a tool, then it could really be applicable or true of anybody. And I find clients and individuals have also become far more discerning, because they would like you to explain to them with examples, what does this mean? So it's not really enough to just explain theoretically a description of a behavior. You have to explain it back to them in their own language, using examples from their own context. And then they should be able to think of real instances in which that behavior may have been displayed. So I'm not aware of a really bang on tool for executive presence, because I don't even see a consistent description of it. But like I said, it continues to be an elusive thing and a popular subject of coaching.
So Tushima, coming in here, we have about 1 minute left. So how much of the presentation is still left, because there is something else also that needs to be covered.
Okay. Yeah. So I think I have just this last one piece to cover.
Okay. So then I think would we kind of request people to stay back. I know we've kind of little bit running out of time. So I think we'll hold our questions for the interaction piece later.
Yes.
Allow Tushima to complete so that we have other couple of things to finish as well.
Thanks. Okay, so I know that we've, you know, that I've already talked about, you know, how a debrief should go and the language of assessments. But this is a point which I cannot emphasize enough, is finally after the tool is selected and done and administered and you've got the report and you're actually sitting across
the table or the screen or the phone or whatever it is from the person, then it's very, very important for the coach to be very neutral and accepting and very inclusive in the kind of language that we are using. So things like you are high on, low on, you are this, you are that, I would say is completely off the table, because labeling is pretty judgmental. We have to keep in mind that the words that we are using will definitely have a permanent and lasting effect on the other person, because there's a lot of trust which has already been built and people have really agreed to share how they are with you. So we receive that trust as a gift and then we handle it with care. So these kind of phrases of you are, you will be, you can, these are absolutes. And like I said, these are off the table. I would actually prefer, and I do open my debriefs first by asking people how the experience of doing the assessment itself was. And I find that that's a great way to build trust, because it creates a lot of autonomy right there to begin with. The language of assessments and of the debrief needs to be simple, specific, and indicative. So you are likely to, it indicates, it suggests what it is likely to mean. In these kinds of situations, you may, and then to always pause and to ask the person what is going through their mind. So then that's where, you know, you really fit it to their context, to their own roles, to their life experiences, and really ask them to come up with instances where they have noticed this about themselves and how this is landing with them and what they would like to do about him. So it has to be aligned back to the context and the contract. To me, assessment and coaching are, you know, a very easy blend. And using the coaching approach when it comes to assessment debriefs is probably the best approach to go, because it's a very, very easy and smooth conversation. And as a coach, you're able to nicely connect the dots. So that's where I'd really like to close. So just to sum up, we've looked at the benefits of using assessments, how you select, the entire range and choice. And we really spoiled for choice today because there are thousands of assessments that are out there. We've looked at a little bit at the psychology or the science, although not in too much detail. We've talked about how it's possible and it's definitely, I would say, totally worth it to offer bundled solutions to your clients today and look at how you can synergize the whole thing. Because like I said, to start with, there's a lot of market acceptance and huge growth potential to really make the most of these two disciplines. So that's all from me for now. And Anu, we can take it forward to the discussion and remaining questions.
Thank you so much, Tushima. I think I'm going to thank you further. Let me quickly ask Nimish to launch the feedback poll. And immediately after the feedback poll is over, I will put up the CCU details. So please, apologies for the slight delay, but bear with me. Please fill up the feedback poll and I, in a matter of a minute, will give you the CCU details in the chat box. And as everybody is filling up the feedback poll, I will do my duty of thanking Tushima. I think it was a very, very informative session. I think we learned a lot. There were different perspectives which were shared, and I think you so beautifully and so patiently took questions while you were presenting. So thank you so much for that.
Thanks very much, Anu. I really hope I was able to cover all the questions that came in. I was pretty conscientious about doing a good job there. And I think now for the rest of the session, we can keep it interactive and, you know, open-ended, and it's probably free to everyone to pitch in.
I will officially close the session now and we will really open it up for our interaction with Tushima, with each other. You could share your experiences, anything particular that you have learned from today that you will want to kind of share.